national championship. The Florida Gators have won the Southeastern Conference championship.
GatorZone is presented by Wells Fargo. Together we'll go far.
Hey everyone, and welcome into a brand new episode of GatorZone. I'm Megan Parla, alongside my co-host this week, Gareth Gutierrez, and we're here at the Atlantis Resort on Paradise Island in the beautiful Bahamas.
That's right, our first ever international edition of GatorZone, and had to leave Jeff behind on the mainland. Didn't want him to enjoy all this, but you know who did enjoy all this? The men's basketball team.
This is the second time in 5 years that they're in the Battle for Atlantis tournament. Seven other teams competing hard, so let's take a look at their week in the Bahamas.
For the second time in the past 5 seasons, the Gators competed in the Battle for Atlantis tournament on Paradise Island in the Bahamas. Each Thanksgiving, the Atlantis Resort transforms one of their ballrooms into the Imperial Arena to allow 8 high-level college teams to compete for the Battle for Atlantis title. This year's field included Oklahoma, Wisconsin, Stanford, Butler, Dayton, Virginia, Middle Tennessee, and Florida. The Gators arrived in the Bahamas 2 nights before the tournament kicked off and filled the open day with a practice, some opponent preparation, and a little free time for the team. Game 1 saw the Gators square off with Oklahoma, led by a familiar face to the UF program in former head coach Lon Kruger.
Goes into the pass left side. Here's Stone for the 3-try. Book it in the left corner. Keith Stone. Reynolds looking to drive. Goes inside. Lost the ball. Here's a steal for Kayvon Allen and a run out. Allen goes down and slam, bam, jam. Ball game is over as the horn sounds, and the Oklahoma Sooners have defeated the Florida Gators here in the opening day of the Battle for Atlantis.
After the loss, the Gators had some time to recoup before squaring off with Stanford, a familiar Thanksgiving week opponent, having faced the Cardinal last season in the PK-80 tournament in Portland, Oregon.
Ducks down, gives it off for Hayes. Hayes fumbling, getting it back though. Hayes goes inside, slam dunk! Side Wills. Wills gets to the elbow, down the lane, goes all the way in. Shot blocked by Stone, and the shot clock will expire. Nimhard on the dribble. Plays it back to Locke, open high to the left. Locke for three, yes! Noah Locke has scored 11, that's a new season and career high for the freshman. Ballard looking to drive. Ballard goes down in and scores off the window. Nice run off the right of the lane. He's got his total of 19 points. In a very decisive victory tonight, Florida has beaten Stanford 72-49.
The victory got Florida back in the win column and set up an interesting scenario where the Gators would meet Butler ahead of an already planned meeting with the Bulldogs in Gainesville on December 29th. This is the first time since the 93-94 season the Gators will play a non-conference opponent twice in the regular season.
Hudson left wing for Hudson, cuts right, steamrolls inside, floats it up, and in, and one for Jalen Hudson. Attacks into the paint, lobs out left to center for Johnson, steamrolls inside, stops on a dime for a short pull-up, that's pure for Keontae Johnson. Steps right, 19-footer on the left angle, hit front rim, rebound for Hayes, and that will do it. Butler defeats Florida 61-54 in the final game from Atlantis.
The 1-2 finish in the Bahamas wasn't what the Gators had in mind, but the trip was a great experience for all involved and continues a recent tradition of mini tournaments around the Thanksgiving holiday. Next season, Florida is already locked into another November tournament as the Gators will compete in the 2019 Charleston Classic.
What a fantastic time down here with the men's basketball team. I will gladly take any time they want to play in any of these early season tournaments, especially if it's in a place nice and warm just like this. Well, a guy that was down here with us for only calling 2 games was Mick Hubert, but he's been around the Gator Nation for a really long time.
Yeah, and he just recently got inducted into the Florida Sports Hall of Fame, so our Shelby Glernath got to catch up with him and kind of relive some of his favorite calls.
Shelby Glernath alongside the voice of the Gators, Mick Hubert. Mick, you were inducted into the Florida Sports Hall of Fame. What did that honor mean to you?
It means more every day than when I got the call in mid-May. I thought, well, this is pretty nice, pretty good. And then, you know, I knew it was going to be 6 months from then. So, you know, life goes on. You start doing your football season, and then it gets closer and closer. And And then when you get there, you realize this is a pretty big deal. There were like 500 people there. And then as I found myself on the stage with all the other recipients, I'm going, what am I doing here? I mean, you look at the list of people who are in that, you know, representing just anyone who's made any type of an impact in the state of Florida, athletically speaking. You know, it gets bigger every day. I'm sure as the years go on, I'll really look back and say, wow, that was quite a pretty special day.
Well, now I want to look back on some of your famous calls and just get your thoughts and kind of take me through the moments.
Third and 10, 28-yard line. Werfel dropping back the throw, pops and fires the ball over the middle. It's there!
Now that was a play when I actually was standing up. You know, we had thrown 7 interceptions in that game. It still stands as an NCAA record for the most interceptions thrown by a winning team in the game. And it looked like we were going to get beat. And then we pulled this one out. And why didn't I say Werfel's got a touchdown? I mean, it was Doering's got a touchdown. He caught the ball. Danny Werfel threw the ball. For that day and time, back in 1993, that was as viral as things could get. You know, that was the call that I always say kind of put me on the map, I think, with Gator fans.
2 seconds, 1 second, horn sounds, ball game is all over. Oh my, the Gators have won the national championship and they've won by 16 points. They dominated UCLA tonight. The Gators are celebrating in Indianapolis a national championship for the basketball team. Oh my.
Yeah, you know, here's this football school, and all of a sudden we get the O4s who had a tremendous career, as we all know, and in that particular year they start the season not ranked, and then they win the national championship, and to do it against a team like UCLA under the great John Wooden, won so many national championships, and so it's not like you're beating somebody no one's ever heard of. You beat UCLA. In a basketball capital like Indianapolis. That was a great one. And then, of course, they would go on and win it again. And the next year, they were number one when the season began and then finished number one at the end. So those back-to-back championships were really special.
That's it. The ball game is all over. Gloves go flying in the air as the fireworks come bursting out of the stands, out of the outfield. Florida has won the national championship in baseball. Oh, my. They've done it. They've won it. Can you believe it? The final score, the Gators 6 and LSU 1.
Well, I remember there now, and I'll try to hold it together here right now because I really didn't have any words for that moment. I mean, Jeff and I were both teared up pretty good, you know, for me to sit there and watch this baseball game and again to do it against LSU in baseball. So to have won that game, so happy for Sully and the coaches and all those players out there. And then I just a moment, just a life flashes through your mind that, wow, there's 3 football championships, 2 basketball championships, and now a baseball championship. And it was special, and I don't think I had one extra word left. I couldn't speak anymore because we were pretty choked up.
Well, Mick, thank you for your time. Thank you for all you do, and good luck this weekend.
Shelby, thank you so much. I hope I get to do this for many, many more years.
We do too. Thank you, Mick.
Thank you, Shelby. And Megan, I think it's time to go check out some more of this fantastic resort.
Let's do that. We'll see you guys right after this first break.
Gator Zone is brought to you by Wells Fargo. Together, we'll go far. And by Gatorade. Win from within.
Welcome back to Gator Zone. Still here in the Bahamas, not going anywhere if it's up to me. And we're currently in, I think, your son's favorite area, the Shark Tank.
Yes, Gareth. Actually, it's called the Predator's Tunnel. But yes, Sawyer's favorite. We've seen all the barracuda, all the sharks, and all the tarpon that this fish tank has to offer.
Well, a few weeks ago here on Gator Zone, we showed you that the gymnastics team adopted a little girl with cancer, took her in, made her part of the team, and now the softball team is doing the same thing.
Yep, it was National Signing Day a couple weeks ago, and they just signed their newest member, Little Hartley.
Over the years, Florida Softball has teamed up with Friends of Jacqueline, a foundation that's goal is to help those children who have pediatric cancer forget about what they're battling when paired with teams. And on a chilly signing day, the Gator softball team signed an inspiring 8-year-old girl, Hartley Georges.
It was just really special. I'm just really excited that it was finally here. I mean, it's been on my heart for a long time to like ask Friends of Jacqueline and ask Coach Walton if we would be open to having another adoptee into our Gator softball family. So I think that it was just really exciting to, it's just so much bigger than softball and so much bigger than college athletics, and just to be able to have an impact on somebody else's life is just what it's all about. So I think it was just a really special moment for us, and we're just so grateful that the Georges family is joining our family. And we couldn't be more excited. Today was just a really special day.
A day meant to put a smile on Hartley's face with all that goes along with a signing day.
Getting to come and watch just a little bit of practice was nice. And then switching fields and the beautiful presentation with the table and the gifts and all the girls just being so warm and welcoming was great. Little gymnastics surprise from Coach Roland was awesome. It's going to definitely help her spirits and keep us in the positive.
Complete with a number 18 jersey to match the senior who knew in her heart that she really needed this little girl in her life.
It was just so special. I saw the jersey yesterday of the number 18, and I was trying to fight back tears a little bit, but it's just so much bigger than softball. I just think it's so special to have any girl have my number on the back of their jersey, but to have, it's really cool just to welcome her, and then the fact that she has my number is really cool, that I just get this little girl in our dugout with my number on the back of her jersey. I just think it's really special. So I'm representing her when I'm out there, and I'm really excited that she's along for this ride, and not only for this year, but we'll be connected forever, and especially to have this as my senior year and having someone like her a part of our family now is just, it's really special. I'm really excited for the journey that we're taking with them now.
Their friendship started that day with a little catch, batting practice, and some red light, green light. For Hartley being a gymnast, the entire team saw her pick up softball quite easily and quickly.
She was so good. We were like asking, oh, have you ever played softball before? She's like, no. And she's hitting the ball, throwing the ball. Her spin was perfect. She's getting ground balls. We had her doing our little hop that we do in the infield, and she was killing it. I mean, she really looked like a natural. Like, by the end of this year, she's going to be looking like one of us for sure. So I think she was having fun. She had a smile on her face, and that's all that matters really. And it was just exciting to see that she likes it, and hopefully the love for softball will continue to grow.
And now Hartley is officially a Gator in more ways than one. Softball may even get the whole family on board.
I'm not a Gator, but I think I am becoming one. And it was cute to see her do the chomp. She has had a lot of practice at the gymnastics meets.
A night the Florida softball team will never forget, with a little girl whose heart that shines through all that she is fighting right now. A bond that is just beginning.
Well, softball has had a rich tradition of helping in the community, and it was from Francesca Anea to Kelsey Horton, and now Amanda Lorenz has stepped up and has really provided a lot for the Georges family.
Certainly great to see, and there's a lot more to see here in the Bahamas, so don't go anywhere. We got another break, and we'll be back.
Gator Zone is brought to you by Wells Fargo. Together, we'll go far. And by Gatorade. Win from within.
Hey everyone, and welcome back inside Gator Zone. Gareth and I made our way over to the Royal Towers here in Atlantis, and they're already ready for Christmas here, G. They've got Christmas trees up, they are ready for the season, and speaking of seasons, a season that just ended a few weeks ago, the soccer season, but they had an amazing senior leader on their team.
That's right, Rachel Smith from Pembroke Pines, a four-year starter on the team as a defender, got hurt this year but was still able to contribute as a member on the sideline. So here's Shelby with more about Rachel.
She's fast. She's tough. She's physical. She's senior defender Rachel Smith, and that's just how she was raised.
My family called it beast mentality. Just always go into stuff hard. Don't ever whine about it. Like, just get back up and go. You're gonna get knocked down, but who cares? Like, you're fine. Get up and go.
Definitely a beast. She goes into crazy tackles that I could never imagine going into. So I think that describes her the best.
The Pembroke Pines native appeared in almost every match for the Orange and Blue in the back line, a position she didn't take lightly, frankly, because of her desire to win.
I hate losing. I used to play offense when I was little, but my dad used to get mad because I was always running back to defense. So I was kind of like, put her in midfield. He's like, no, just keep her in defense, but she's not going to do it. She'll just stay back there, and that's how I got stuck at defense.
Rachel's beast mode mentality was put to the test not long into her senior season. The Gators traveled to Tallahassee mid-September to take on in-state rival Florida State. Rain and lightning forced the teams to head to the locker room in the middle of the second half. And when play was resumed, Smith did not have a good feeling about the remainder of the game.
You get back in the field, like, I still had the mindset like something's gonna happen. Like, something always happens when I play FSU. I'm like, it's gonna happen, I'm just gonna have to deal with it. And then when I went to go kick the ball, the girl bumped me and I landed too early on my foot. I already knew what happened. Went down, screamed for Connie. Connie looks at me, he's like, Rachel, what's wrong? I'm like, 6 months, automatically. She's like, we don't know that yet. I'm like, I know, 6 months.
Rachel's initial hunch was later confirmed, a torn ACL. Even though number 81 was devastated her career would end on the sideline, in the back of her mind, she recalled what it means to her family to be a beast.
I gave myself at least an hour to 2 hours to physically understand what is happening to my body and what just happened. But after those 2 hours, I just remember going back to how my family brought me up. It's like, hey, it happened, move on. You can't do anything from it. Let's see how you can process from it and like get better from the injury.
And that's exactly what Rachel did. The player who was known for her tough love mindset had to learn how to use an influential voice on the sideline.
Towards the end of our season, going into the SEC tournament, I finally realized what that means. And it wasn't more so giving direction, it was more so just encouraging them, like, it's fine, keep going, keep going. And I didn't realize how much of an impact that had until after the game. They're like, keep screaming for us on the sidelines. Like, oh, okay, I got you, I can do that. They finally got to see that, like, hey, she's a hard head, but she's actually trying to push for us to do better, and that's all she wanted. And I think for me, like, that was awesome to see that they could finally see that. And I took a different role, a different route of doing it for them to acknowledge it and be like, oh, okay, now I understand.
No matter what, on the sideline, like, she tried to stay positive as much as she could and just continued to bring her fight to the field, even though she wasn't on the field.
Smith says the thing she'll miss most about her time in orange and blue is playing with her teammates and the family atmosphere this program embodies.
Every time we went on the field, we did it for someone else. We never did it for ourselves. And we always wanted the best out of each other just to win. Like, and even if we didn't win and we gave it all, we were proud with it because we knew we pushed ourselves to the limit.
Rachel Smith was a beast on defense for the Florida Gators. Whether she was on the field or on the sideline, she brought a passion and a fire to this team that will be hard to replace. For GatorZone, I'm Shelby Grenat.
Thank you, Shelby. Well, from a senior who plays football whose season is over to a redshirt junior who plays football who still has a bowl game left.
That's right, Gareth. Jordan Scarlett has been running the ball hard all year, so we can't wait to see his performance in the bowl game. And I know we said we left Jeff behind, but you got a little sneak of Jeff this episode. He is with Jordan Scarlett.
Hey everybody, Jeff Cardozo here, joined by Jordan Scarlett. This guy totes a rock and he does it very, very well for the Florida Gator football team. And you know, let's start there, Jordan. Florida Gators, why come here? I know South Florida guy probably had some influence of going down there and you made your way up to Gainesville.
Yeah, I actually did have a little influence of staying down south, but you know, I had a teammate, Quincy Wilson, in high school, and when I came up here, you know, he brought me in and showed me the great things about Florida and, you know, told me what it is to be a Gator. And so I fell in love with it ever since.
And when you got here, I'm sure you didn't have these things. Holy smokes, look at that right there. Just this is like a Smedium shirt. I got to get one of those. But, you know, that's something you guys going into this season and the offseason, all the workouts, stuff like that. That's been a huge impact for you, hasn't it?
Yeah, you know, especially with the new training staff now, they definitely, you know, those guys actually take a lot of their time to, you know, make sure that we're doing things right and, you know, we're working hard.
But I think when we see you on the field, though, all the Gator fans out there, they understand that when you get hit, you don't go down. I know, you know, we've seen your Pro Football Focus said you had more missed tackles than anybody else in the SEC a couple years ago. So where does that mentality come from?
You know, I think it's just me running with a relentless effort, you know, that I'm not going to let one guy bring me down or I'm not going to go down, period. So that's just the kind of mentality I have when I'm running the ball, and it works out pretty well.
Yeah, no, it certainly does. What else works out well? Like, what are you doing when you're not running the football? Are you just hanging out with the rest of the crew?
Yeah, hanging out with the guys. Well, I got a pit bull back home. I'm definitely taking care of him majority of the time and play a lot of Fortnite and Madden. So, gamer too. I play on the games a lot.
So the dances, like, what was that thing and all that, you know, all that stuff?
Yeah, I know, but I ain't too much of a dancer. You know, I dance every once in a while.
So even after a touchdown, no Fortnite moves?
Oh, Mike can pull out a Fortnite move for you after a touchdown, yeah.
Well, sweet. Now, speaking of touchdowns, do you remember your first one here?
Yes, I do. You know, it was in the south end zone, and I ran an outside zone, and it was great. And it was a great feeling having a lot of people cheering for you, regardless of what time it was in the game. You know, the swamp's always packed.
And now here's another running play to Scarlett. Off the left side, and Scarlett will waltz in through a big hole. That's a touchdown run from Jordan Scarlett.
Appreciate your time, man. Obviously, best of luck, and we'll keep it going.
Thank you. Go Gators.
Megan, I don't know if we could have brought Jeff along on this trip anyways, because I kind of feel like the whole time he would have been shooting down here, he would have just been turned around staring at the fish.
I'm not going to lie, Garrett's probably right. So let's get to our last break here on GatorZone, and we come back, I think we have something up our swimsuits for top plays. Well, as promised, G is in his swimsuit, and we're ready for some top plays. Here's some better ones from our student athletes.
Today's top plays are brought to you by Nike.
Winston driving down the side and lost the ball. A steal picked up by Nimhard. Ahead to Ballard. Ballard loves it to Keontae Johnson. Bam! Dunk! Oh my! KJ high in the sky for the slammer.
Wow, he caught that one above the square, Mick.
He's got a 41-inch vertical. He had the ball knocked away, stolen by Florida. Nimhard gets it ahead to Locke. Bam! Dunk! The first assist today for Nimhard on a run-out dunk for Locke. Now for the Gators. And here's an inbound pass. Stolen. Nimhard on a steal. And Nimhard runs down and lays it in. The Gators need points this possession. Right wing Allen. He's open for a three try. Book it! Allen on a three ball. Right wing. Give the assist to Nimhard.
Florida on 11-3 run. Lead by 8. Out of the right corner, Johnson jumps from 3. You bet! Ariel Johnson buries the 3. Florida by 11. Johnson, who is double left block, looks to get it away and hooks it towards the top of the keeper, Washington. Big strides in the paint. Sends it right block for Williams, who banks it in. What a tremendous trip.
That was great. Obviously, they have been working on that. We've seen 3-4 dribble drives dish off to Zeta Williams for the finish.
7 seconds, 6 seconds. Smith curls left with contact, whips it left corner. Staples on a 3. You bet! Corey Staples knocks down the 3, and the Gators have a 23-point lead through 3 quarters.
I don't think mine was much of a top play, but a good thing is the student athletes saved us, because those were some real top plays. Hey, that'll do it for our first ever international edition of GatorZone, but there are so many ways to follow us once we get back to the mainland.
That's right. You can follow all your favorite Gator teams on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat.
Well, that'll do it for this edition of GatorZone. For my partner,
Megan Parler,
I'm Gareth Gutierrez, and the wonderful camera work of Courtney Culbreth. This is GatorZone. We'll see you next time.